Next on Weapons at War. Weighing over 60 tons, it still maneuvers over any terrain with amazing speed and agility. With guns that can blast through any enemy's armor from over a mile away. These incredible technological wonders evolved from the ponderous land battleships of World War I, won bitter victories on every front in World War II, and moved decisively over the sands of the Middle East. The tank. Next on Weapons at War.
In 1482, Leonardo da Vinci wrote, "I am building secure and covered chariots which are invulnerable. And when they advance with their guns into the midst of the foe, even the largest enemy masses must retire." Some 400 years later, Leonardo's armored chariot rumbled under the scarred terrain of the Western Front. And as the machine evolved, so did the tactics to exploit its enormous firepower. With strategists like Guderian, Patton, and Rommel, the tank emerged as the dominant weapon of land warfare.
The armies that marched to battle in World War I were still best suited to the musket and the cavalry charge. Little had changed in the pattern of warfare since the 19th century. Long lines of trenches, intricate barbed wire defenses, a mass of mud churned up by unyielding artillery fire, and short, often futile, infantry attacks, where advances were more often measured in yards than miles. These were the circumstances that led to the development of the tank.
In the early days of the war, the Allied forces did use armored cars, particularly to rescue downed pilots. But as the static situation developed, trenches, barbed wire, obviously armored cars could not cross this type of terrain. So tanks were developed in order to cross a terrain swept by machine gun fire, covered in barbed wire and covered in very deep trenches, which armored cars could clearly not operate in.
Winston Churchill, then First Lord of the British Admiralty, advocated the development of land ships. Farm tractor tread designs inspired the first top secret experiments. For security, they were called tanks.
Well, the word tank came, in fact, as a cover story during the First World War when they were developing these vehicles, and they did tend to look like water tanks. So people did not know exactly what they were, they just happened to call them tanks. And that name has stuck right through this day. The very first British tank was called Little Willie, and that actually was a full-track vehicle with just a very large superstructure, but that did prove the basic concept.
In December 1915, the first British Mark I tank lumbered out of the laboratory. It was nicknamed Big Willie, or Mother. This was the first of the series of British tanks with the lozenge or rhomboid shape. Production began in February 1916, and in July, the world's first tank saw action at the Battle of the Somme. The These early tanks weighed 31 tons and had a top speed of less than 4 miles per hour. Of their 8-man crew, it took 4 just to steer. The range of the tanks was only 15 miles. Improvements in armor and armament continued throughout the war, the most common design being the Mark IV. Over 1,200 Mark IVs were built. The tanks were built in 2 versions, a male and a female. The male was armed with 2 naval 6-pounder guns, the female, 4 machine guns. The French were also pioneers in tank development. The Renault FT-17, nicknamed the Mosquito, was one of the most important early designs. It weighed less than 5 tons, so it could be transported by truck. This made for fast deployment and helped prevent track breakage, a continual problem with the early tanks. The FT was the first armored vehicle to adopt the modern tank layout with a turning turret, rear engine, and raised superstructure.
In driving the old Renault one-man battle tank, it was a feeling that you were invincible because you could hear the bullets hit the sides and you felt invincible. And you could go right over the wire because it was powerful enough to tear the wire loose from the steel stanchions it was wound into. And they were very effective. Infantry loved them. They always welcomed them, because if they had a specially tough machine gun nest that were going to take a lot of men and a lot of lives to get, probably, you could run right on up to it, just like your thumb in your nose out, and go right up to it and shoot right into the aperture and clean them out. The sensation of driving one of these things is terrible, because it's terribly confining. And the engine, you're practically sitting on the engine, and the noise of the engine, the noise of the guns, and the concussions outside the tank, and the general, it's like being in a maelstrom of noise and racket and discomfort. It's terribly hot, and you're just tickle pink to get the damn thing back to where you can park it and get out of it.
In November 1917, at the Battle of Cambrai, the British massed 400 tanks in a concentrated assault. For the first time, tanks were used not just as infantry support, but to initiate an attack.
So there was a continual debate in the development of the tank as to whether it was an infantry weapon that was absolutely, it existed to support the individual infantryman in taking his objective, or was it a new, significantly different form of battlefield capability that should in its own right be supported to strike deep, achieve objectives that were beyond the imagination of the individual infantryman.
By the war's end, the British built more than 2,300 tanks of 13 different designs. The French more than 4,000 light and heavy tanks. However, the Germans built just 20. Their design required an 18-man crew. The U.S. tank program was in its infancy when the war ended. The American Mark VIII was designed to, quote, win the war in 1919, unquote. The U.S. Tank Corps fought in British and French tanks. America's very first tank commander was to make his mark in future battles. His name was George Patton. As the euphoria that marked the end of the Great War died away, so did interest in tank production. Surplus vehicles were relegated to the scrap heap. Throughout the world, there were still many pioneers interested in tank design and tactics. However, for the most part, their voices went unheard.
In France, it was De Gaulle. In Germany, Guderian. In Britain, it was Liddell Hart, JFC Fuller. They saw the tanks as more than mechanized cavalry, but still an important cavalry role in which you would puncture the enemy lines, get behind it, not worry about your flanks, capture communications, disorganize the enemy. And also they saw them operated in force. They didn't see them operated in ones and twos. It was an amazing thing that in every country there were people who had the right idea about how to employ tanks and wrote about how to employ tanks and were read by their counterparts in other countries who understood them and who all universally were ignored in their own countries.
In the late 20s, a brilliant American designer named J. Walter Christie created a light, fast tank that could travel cross-country at amazing speeds on his revolutionary torsion bar suspension. The U.S. Army bought a few Christie tanks, but basically, America ignored his ideas. Christie's T3 featured a removable track. The tank could ride on its wheels for high-speed travel.
Back in the days when tanks went 13 miles an hour, Christie claimed that this one could go 125. And it probably would go 125. The Army tested it out at 70 miles an hour on the wheels, and the Army got it up to about 40 miles an hour on the tracks. He sold it to the Russians. And if you take a look at this suspension system, the Christie suspension system, and you take a look at the Russian BT series, or even better still, the T-34, you'll see it's nothing more than the Christie suspension system. And the Christie suspension system stays the basic suspension system for the Soviet Army right up to the T-62 tank that they produced in the 60s.
By the late 30s, the American Army ranked 19th in the world. It was woefully lacking in manpower and equipment. The total budget for tank development was only $85,000 per year. The mechanized force included passenger cars with boilerplate armor. However, visionary leaders like George Patton and Adna Chaffee staged war games to generate media attention and funds for an improved force. Emphasis was placed on light, fast infantry support tanks. The M2 tank was known for its twin turret design. It was nicknamed the May West for rather obvious reasons. The tank was lightly armored and armed, and fortunately never had to prove itself on the battlefield. The M2 evolved into the M3 light tank. This quick, reliable vehicle became the first American tank to see combat.
It's a light tank, has a 37 millimeter gun, very fast. The British call it the honey because it was a honey of a tank. They used it in North Africa to maneuver to the flanks and to the rear of the Italians and the German tanks to shoot them from the rear. The problem with the tank is that it's very, very lightly armored and could only be used really in a scouting role. You can't use it in a slugging match with armor. You have to maneuver at very high speeds to keep the other guy from shooting you.
April 20th, 1938. To celebrate Hitler's 50th birthday, the Nazi Party proudly displays their weapons of war. The Treaty of Versailles had banned Germany from tank production. However, work continued as prototypes were called Traktoren to disguise their identity. Then, as the Nazis came to power, production of the Panzerkampfwagens began openly with designs concentrating on the all-important tank characteristic, firepower. Blitzkrieg, lightning war. heavy concentrations of tanks and air power smashing through enemy lines, destroying supply and artillery positions, and shattering the enemy's will to resist. With the devastating attacks on Poland and Western Europe in 1939, the Germans proved the value of the strategy. The same strategy advocated by the British theorists years before and perfected by German leaders like Heinz Guderian and Erwin Rommel. Blitzkrieg demonstrated superior tactics would prevail even against superior weapons.
Prior to the invasion of France in 1940, in fact, the British and French had more tanks than the Germans. Some of our tanks were very good, but we did not know really how to use our tanks. We tended to spread them too thin, where the Germans would concentrate their armor and use it en masse. We had the tanks, we had the artillery, but we could not really use them as a combined arms team. Therefore, we lost the Battle of France.
With Blitzkrieg, the Germans had turned the tank into the dominant weapon of ground warfare, and the Panzer tank crews became the most feared fighting men on Earth.
We always talk about equipment. It is the motivation of the man, how he's trained, how he's led. And that certainly had a major part to play of the effectiveness of the German army. They were well-led, they were well-motivated. Perhaps some of the Allied countries, perhaps as France, they did not have that same motivation or backup the German soldier had.
But inevitably, with triumph comes tragedy for both the victors and the vanquished. North African campaign, Erwin Rommel and his Afrika Corps were locked in a brutal ebb and flow struggle with Montgomery and the British. The Germans continued to improve their Panzerkampfwagen series with bigger guns and heavier armor. These were formidable tanks, but the designs proved complex and difficult to manufacture and maintain. In 1942, they introduced the legendary 56-ton Tiger tank. It was a machine of awesome power, but the Tiger was slow and often unreliable. The British countered with their own light tanks, like the Crusader and Matilda, but eventually they looked to America for greater firepower. The mass production skills of the American auto industry were harnessed to meet the needs of Allied tank manufacturing. In April of 1941, less than 7 months after construction of the factory began, the first M3 medium tank was delivered. Known as the General Grant and General Lee, the tanks were quickly shipped to the British in North Africa. They were armed with a 75-millimeter gun that was mounted on the side, not in the turret.
One of the first tanks used by the British Army from the American under the Lend-Lease program was the Grant and Lee. Automotively, it was a very good tank. They couldn't develop one with a turret at that time for a number of technical reasons. So in order to get a vehicle in production, they had to put the gun in a sponson on one side, like the First World War tanks. But this had a number of tactical limitations, as found out by the British in some of the North African battles. Particularly, we had a problem in engaging targets over a wide arc. The driver had to change direction in order to lay the gun on the target.
In 1942, General George Patton and the American forces joined the North Africa campaign in the M3 tanks. Rommel wrote, quote, "The advent of the new American tank has torn great holes in our ranks, unquote. However, at home, design work continued on an improved medium tank. The Americans, too, had discovered the deficiencies of the M3.
The M3 was simply awful. it was called a bucket of death because it had been put together with bolts, welded bolts. And whenever it took a hit, why, those bolts would buzz around inside of the tank like bees. You got as much damage from them as you did from the explosion of the shells.
After many historic tank battles, the Allies eventually overcame Rommel and the Afrika Korps.
Although we outnumbered him, he did use his tanks to a better advantage and certainly did give the British a good run for their money on many occasions. But his supply lines were very long. So in the end, he didn't have enough fuel, ammunition was short, and he was eventually pushed out of North Africa.
On the Eastern Front, the fine Soviet T-34 tanks were surprising the Germans with their speed and maneuverability. In response, the Germans developed the 50-ton Panther tank. Along with the T-34, the Panther is considered by many the finest tank of World War II. In America, the new M4 Sherman medium tanks were rolling off the assembly lines. Before the war's end, over 50,000 Shermans would be produced. It was armed with a 75-millimeter main gun, housed in a motorized turret, able to rotate 360 degrees. The track was an excellent rubberized design, giving the five-man crew a durable ride cross-country and on highways. The highly maneuverable Sherman was rugged, reliable, easy to produce, and simple to maintain. Shermans fought for virtually every Allied army in almost every theater of the war. The Sherman tank is considered one of the most important armored vehicle designs in history.
After what we had gone through, it was like a blessing. I mean, we couldn't, some of us would stay in it the whole night just to get acquainted with it. It was a delight. It was brand new and it had everything we'd been missing.
But during battle, tank crews soon discovered the Sherman too had glaring deficiencies. The armor was far too thin and the gun far too small compared to the German King Tiger and Panther tanks.
In Normandy, if you sent three or four Shermans after a Panther, you might well knock out the Panther, but you will probably lose three of your Shermans, because the Panther had much better armor protection and a much better gun.
The Panther had a gun, a PAC 42 75 millimeter gun, which would develop right at 3,300 foot second muzzle velocity. Compare that with our Sherman tank, with this little M275, which was 2,050 foot second muzzle velocity. That means that tank, that gun could go all the way through our tank and out the other side, and we couldn't even get through the front of that tank.
We could outrun them. We could outshoot them on a straight run, but we could never, very, very seldom knock them out. Because our, like the shell, they would just bounce right off the tanks. If you hit them in the front, forget it. They would just smash that shell in pieces and wouldn't even penetrate.
It's an awful feeling, I'll tell you that. You're shooting and it's bouncing off of them and they're firing at you and they're going through you like a hot knife through butter.
I felt like that we had been victims of a tragic misunderstanding because I had been to tank school. I'd seen the M4 Sherman tank, and I'd been told that that was the best tank going, and I believed it. I believed it better than German tanks. I didn't know that German tanks were like they were. Our men went into Normandy believing that those tanks were good and that they were equal to or better than German tanks. When we got in there, it was a real tragedy to see it was the other way around. Our division had fantastic loss. We lost 87 tanks going the first 7 miles through those hedgerows. It was just horrendous.
Another problem with the Sherman was that ammunition storage was poor, so the tank caught fire easily. Crews eventually nicknamed it the Ronson Lighter because it always lit the first time. During the European campaign, the losses in the Sherman were tremendous. New tanks arrived from America, but new crews had to be trained in the field.
They brought down about 3 truckloads of raw infantry replacements. These kids had just gotten off the boat from Antwerp, and they'd only had basic training. They brought them down there. We asked with any tank drivers amongst them, no tank drivers, nobody ever even had training in tank at all. We had 17 tanks to issue out, which was equivalent to a whole company, and we put them in the tanks, and we got our artillery sergeant to teach them how to fire the main gun. And each man got to fire that gun 3 times, and that's all the training they had. And we issued those tanks out about 5:30, 6 o'clock that night. Went down there again about 8 o'clock that night, or later, and of those 17 tanks, 15 of them were knocked out on the side of the road. I don't know whether any of those men survived or not, but I thought that was a real tragedy that we'd had to send those young men into battle without any training at all because of the tremendous losses we'd taken prior to that.
Despite the shortcomings, the sheer numbers of the Sherman prevailed.
It was a magnificent testament to American industry that we were able to produce the quality that was the quantity of the Sherman tank in a relatively short period of time. But it was a situation of having to literally use your wits because basically you were outgunned and you were out-armored.
I had what was called a short barrel 75, the main advantage being that you could go between trees, whereas long barrels get hung up. We caught Germans because their guns were so long that they couldn't swing between trees, you know. So whenever we saw that they were in between trees, then we'd go around the side and try to get them through the turret, which was very good. We liked that.
Ingenious modifications developed. A rocket launcher tank, a flamethrower. The British created a minesweeper version. A bulldozer tank was used to cut through the thick hedgerows of Normandy. Soon, an improved hedge cutter was devised.
It meant that instead of the Germans being able to say, well, they know that the breakthrough is going to come where we had a bulldozer. But with these hedge choppers, they were so low to the ground, the Germans couldn't tell whether the tank was equipped with a hedge chopper or not. So as a result of that, instead of being able to break through at 2 or 3 places, we were able to break through 10 or 12 places at one time. And it was extremely effective.
Even through the bitter cold of the Battle of the Bulge, the Sherman proved reliable. With the help of coordinated air power and ingenious crews, the Sherman eventually became known as the tank that won the war. But crewmen still feel very fortunate to have survived.
I feel lucky, and I prayed a lot. As a matter of fact, I carry the rosary beads that my mother gave me, and to this day, they're in my jacket. I still use them. And I think that helped me get through it. I really do.
I'm damn lucky that I'm here today. I only got a couple scratches. Outside of that, everything was pretty good. A lot of my buddies never made it. Never made it back. I'm getting goose pimples.
By the end of the Second World War, the conclusive tank doctrine remained unwritten. The debate over whether tanks should be spearheading attacks or supporting the infantry still raged. And the coming conflict in Korea did little to resolve the stalemate.
The terrain limited somewhat the use of the tank in Korea. The enemy tanks were limited by the fact that they were suppressed by our air power. Simply, when they appeared, they were eradicated by the superior air power. American tanks weren't able to be employed in the classic manner as they had been in the past because the Korean mountain passes and so forth dictated that they move along the roads. But they're still important and forced back into the original role that the British had employed upon them as augmenting the troops as a means of providing local firepower and local protection to the troops.
Improved Sherman tanks, M-26 Pershings and M-24 Chaffee tanks, were deployed to Korea. Often their role was limited to augmenting artillery batteries.
On the other side, the North Koreans used mainly Russian tanks, particularly the T-34. When the T-34s came across the border, the Americans really were taken aback because they couldn't knock them out. They'd lost the edge. Their bazookas could not take out some of the Russian tanks used by the North Koreans and then later the Chinese. But really, the Korean campaign was really an infantry campaign. The terrain didn't suit highly mobile operations. You could certainly use tanks to push forward, but there were not many tank via tank operations.
After the war, America experimented with a series of super heavy tanks with guns ranging up to 155 millimeters. Most were too cumbersome for standard operation. The T-95 tank weighed 100 tons. The Soviets, too, continued their armor development with modifications to their T-34 and K-5 tanks. In 1952, America introduced the M-48 Patton medium tank to replace the Sherman. This remained the primary U.S. tank through the Vietnam War.
When the American Army first deployed to Vietnam, it was widely thought the tank had no role there. But once offensive operations started, it was soon realized that tanks did have a role. And M48 tanks were sent out there, and also the Vietnamese were given tanks, particularly M48s. And those tanks were used in offensive operations to provide fire support and to break down the bush for the infantry to go through.
First and foremost, Vietnam was truly the infantryman's war. The role of armor was one of supporting the infantryman in the accomplishment of his mission. Traditionally, the infantry had literally done the bread and butter attack while armor forces went around the flank, got into the enemy's rear and what have you, working potentially with airborne forces. In Vietnam, you had a role reversal in that the armored forces, because of their firepower and their mobility in many parts of the country, were able to basically keep the pressure on while infantry, now helicopter mounted, could move decisively to engage the enemy at times and places unanticipated by the enemy.
Despite limited use, many types of armored vehicles were deployed to Vietnam. The M48s, Sheridans, and Walker Bulldog tanks fought along with the M113 armored personnel carriers.
Vietnam was a challenging time to be in the mounted force. Your feeling was that in any group, you tend to draw fire. In other words, because of the capability, you instantly become a target for anything that the enemy has that they think is sufficiently good to get you, as opposed to getting to the infantryman that may be walking to your side.
Tanks did play a vital role in Vietnam, and on retrospect, perhaps they should have been used there rather earlier than they were done at the end of the day.
The M60 tank evolved from the M48, becoming America's first main battle tank. Despite its 30-year-old design, it fought very successfully in the 1991 Gulf War, with the addition of advanced electronics and explosive reactive armor.
Until fairly recently, all tanks had basically steel armor. to improve survivability, you got it, you made it thicker. But in recent years, there have been a number of programs to improve the survivability of tanks. One is the development of explosive reactive armor. In fact, basically what this consists of is two sheets of steel with the explosives between them. They are fitted in small boxes or blocks on the outside of the tank. And when that block is hit by another high explosive anti-tank projectile, that causes the explosion between the plates to go off and the plates move. And the outside plate goes outwards and eats up the incoming jet. So that really helps improve the survivability of the tank.
The M60 has also been upgraded with a British designed 105mm main gun.
The 105 main gun can punch through anything that we've come across so far on the battlefield. For our three or four basic rounds that we actually use right now, number one round is the Sabo. And the Sabo round is our primary tank killing round. It's nothing more than a depleted uranium projectile that fires out at a speed of 4,850 feet per second. Cruising at a speed this fast, it just crashes through the armor of just about any tank around. We also have a heat round that stands for high explosive anti-tank. Now the way that works, it impacts on a very small spot on the tank, and it shoots a shaped charge. It focuses the explosive power on a specific point. And to do this, it basically sends a stream of molten metal through the tank. And as this goes through the tank, it does the same thing. It heats up the tank and causes internal explosions inside the tank. The greatest strength of the M60 is the crew that operates it. If you get a crew who's knowledgeable and knows how to run the tank, it's going to take you a long ways. And that's exactly what it did when we were deployed to Saudi Arabia and Kuwait. We had good people over there who knew how to run their tanks, and we came back without a casualty, which says a whole lot for us.
Inside a turret, you know, it's a scary place to be because you can't see what's coming at you, you know, what's about to hit you. You may be outside for 1 second, and the minute you drop down to put a round in the breech, you may get hit. You know, it's just something you gotta block out of your mind when you come down here.
You know, hell, it's like anything else, you know. Every job has hazards. You know, ours are just a little bit more final than others. But when it's actually taking place, you have your job to do. You don't have time to think about it, because if you do, then you're not doing your job. And when you're not doing your job, you're endangering the lives of your other three crewmen. And we don't do that.
In Desert Storm, the M60 faced far more modern adversaries. Success can be attributed to the teamwork and camaraderie of the tank crews.
Just a couple hours before we moved out, I had just a couple of minutes, and I asked my tank commander, you know, if I could go over to our wingman's tank real quick. And he said, sure, go ahead, just, you know, hurry up back. So it happened to be my best friend. And there has never been an emotion that I felt that would has any, you know, comparison to, you know, saying to him, you know, see you later. You try to downplay it, you know, like, you know, I'll see you later, you know, like that. But will you? You know, you don't know.
Today's main battle tanks achieve a fine balance between speed and power. With its decisive victories in the Persian Gulf, America's M1A1 Abrams is now considered perhaps the best tank in the world. The Abrams is armed with a German-designed 120mm smoothbore gun capable of engaging targets over 6 miles away. It's powered by a 1,500 horsepower turbine engine, giving the tank an excellent power-to-weight ratio.
The way we used to initially describe the Abrams, before it was issued to you as a crewman or in a platoon or what have you, was that you think you're getting a tank. What you're really getting is a helicopter. It just happens to float on the ground. But think of yourself at that level of speed and capability and what have you.
The M1 is fitted with highly sophisticated electronics. A fully stabilized gun, a laser rangefinder, and night vision systems for the commander, gunner, and driver.
Once they acquire the target, till the time that they have a round loaded and the gunner says on the way and fires a round and it goes out there, it can be maybe 5 to 10 seconds. It's got the maneuverability and speed that allows us to tactically put that 120 millimeter on the enemy where he's most susceptible to our ammunition.
Our major goal in the development of the Abrams tank was the survivability of the individual crewmen. As a group, we were just absolutely convinced that it was our mission, our role, our desire to ensure that when mounted soldiers in the tank portion of the mounted battlefield went to battle again, that they would never be put at the kind of disadvantage that the American armored mounted soldier had of World War II in the Sherman tank.
The front 60% of the M1 is covered with Chobham armor, a top secret material developed by the British. The armor makes the tank virtually immune to most anti-tank weapons.
Basically, the actual matrix and the makeup of Chobham armor is highly classified, and they've never stated what it is. But Chobham armor gives you protection of both against heat attack and also kinetic energy attack.
To protect the four-man crew, ammunition is stored in compartments that explode to the outside if the tank is hit.
With a compartmentalized ammunition, then if something happens to the ammunition, it goes off and it's expelled to the outside rather than to the inside. And venting that flame and heat and destruction from our own ammunition to the outside really helps us stay in the tank and then go ahead and fight the tank once we get resupplied.
Perhaps the greatest aid to survivability are the intense training programs the tank crews are subjected to.
Right tank, identify.
Up.
Fire. All the way. Target. Moving tank. Identify.
Up.
Fire. All the way. Target. Fire. Fire.
Even simulators have been developed for mock battlefield training. The future generation of the tank is the M1A2, which will be equipped with even more advanced electronic vision systems.
With all that equipment, you've got to be a college graduate to run it. I mean, laser and all, and it's really something.
I got in the tank and they showed me how to work the gun and the instrument. I did everything but shoot the gun, and I really got a bang out of it. And I would say that the difference between the M1 main battle tank and the M4 Sherman that we went to Normandy with was as much difference as a Model T Ford and a brand new Cadillac. I mean, it was awesome difference.
There are many great battle tanks in the world today. The British Challenger has a 120 millimeter gun and Chobham armor. The German Leopard 2 also fires the 120 millimeter gun. And the Soviet Union has its T-80 with a 125 millimeter main gun. Total victory in the Gulf was due to precise coordination between the air and land forces, as well as the dedication of the tank crews.
Dad, for 96 hours straight. But yet, I'm really surprised. The guy's morale's pretty good. You know, some people complain about lack of sleep, but overall, they know that the quickest way to go home lies up to the north. So we're gonna get the job done.
Throughout the 20th century, the tank evolved from its plodding beginnings to an awesome technological achievement in protection, mobility, and firepower. But through all the change, one thing remains constant. Victory in tank warfare, as in all warfare, depends on the genius of the tacticians and the training, commitment, and courage of the soldiers. Victory is not the triumph of superior machines, but the triumph of the human spirit.